This is the Bristol Assembly Hall. It was built to serve the 16,000 family members of Jehovah's Witnesses who live in Wales and the West Country. Worldwide, there are over 5 million Jehovah's Witnesses who meet twice yearly in groups of about 1,000 for regional circuit assemblies. Many buildings are used for these meetings. Often a public hall is rented, but where there are sufficient numbers, it's possible for them to own their own hall dedicated to the worship of Jehovah God. Thus, in 1985, it was agreed to build such a hall in the Bristol area. For many years, the project was dogged with problems, but the real need for a hall appropriate to true worship drove the project on. Finally, this site in Hawtham Lane, Almondsbury was located, and after several years of negotiations, work began in September 1993. Many people assumed that the hard part was now over, and that within a few months, the hall would be complete. But it was to be a far bigger project than that. The approved design called for the hall to be embedded into the side of the hill, with the excavated spoils spread around the outside to form large landscaped banks. It became the biggest theocratic civil engineering project ever attempted, and using outside contractors, it took over a year to achieve. By the autumn of 1994, they had completed the excavation and the hall was beginning to take shape. The most remarkable phase of the work now began, for all the finishing work was to be carried out by the witnesses themselves. They would lay 64,000 bricks and 114 tons of stone. They would install miles of pipe and electrical cables, and they would create a beautifully sculptured ceiling over a luxuriously appointed auditorium. But the most amazing thing about this project was that almost all of these workers were volunteers who freely gave of their time and skills, and all the finance was raised by voluntary contributions. No other organization could achieve this feat because no other organization is involved with the true worship of Jehovah. So the people did not achieve this in their own strength, but as the psalmist said, Jehovah has done this great thing. The project was overseen by a committee of men who were chosen for their spiritual qualities rather than construction experience. Unlike commercial building sites, volunteers had to satisfy spiritual requirements rather than technical ones. These high spiritual values had a profound effect on the atmosphere of the site and enabled trades to cooperate in difficult situations, treating each other as brothers and sisters from a huge construction family. It seemed that everyone who worked here had an interesting story to tell. Some, like Sister Iris Beatty, could remember when, in the early 1940s, there were only a few witnesses in Bristol.
When we moved from Seamills to Avon House, we met in a little room above a garage. Now, the garage only held one car, so as you can imagine, it was a very small room. There was no light, no heat, no water, no toilets, nothing. But there was some, there was a little harmonium in the corner. Sister Pugsley used to play it, used to, you know, sing the songs to it. And it was lit for the meetings with a paraffin lamp, one of these that you pump up. And every once now and again, one of the brothers would jump up and start frantically pumping at the lamp so it would burn brighter for us to see. Because we used to do the written review by the aid of this lamp, and it was a bit dim sometimes.
The 40s were exciting times. This meeting was held in the Co-op Hall, Bristol, in 1941, when Brother Price Hughes, a member of the Anointed Class, was released after a term in prison for his stand on neutrality. Immediately after the meeting, Bristol was blitzed by German bombers. These pioneers, pictured outside their home in Dublin Crescent, were well known in the area and contributed to the tremendous growth in Jehovah's Witnesses in Bristol. This growth in Bristol over the years is a prime example of the way Jehovah has done a great thing. The hard work of these brothers was certainly blessed. They used this Ford 8 van to advertise Brother Rutherford's lectures, played on a phonograph at the Kingdom Hall. When Brother Rutherford visited Bristol, his public talk, Government and Peace, was advertised widely. Can you imagine the interest these brothers and sisters generated as they marched through the streets of Bristol? The talk was even advertised on a yacht at Bristol Docks. There was a thriving congregation in Bristol even earlier than this. Sister Winnie Richards, a member of the Anointed Class, came into the truth in 1919. She remembers the small beginnings, particularly the Kingdom Hall.
We used to meet in a little back room of a coffee house down in St. Jude's. And the children would separate after the hymn and prayer and go into the Sunday school, where we went through the Harp of God book with one of the Order brothers or sisters. It was a wonderful time.
In 1944 and 1946, memorable assemblies at Bristol were held entirely under canvas. They were advertised in a very novel way. The experience is remembered by Sister Nora Richards.
And we engaged, didn't we, very often in bicycle rides, advertising, and all around Bristol. And it really did make quite an impression. And it was a thrilling time altogether.
The first time Nora went placard advertising, she went up past our firm where we worked. We worked in a chemist, manufacturing chemist, and all the men were stood outside. And they were amazed, of course, to see us. And then there was another time when we went cycle riding. We went all up around Noel, and the children up there, they had pea shooters. They said, oh, there's hundreds of them coming. And they started pelting us with pea shooters. It was a wonderful time, really. Actually, I think we were making wasp sandwiches there, because we were making jam and cheese sandwiches, and the wasps were flying around, and we got stung once or twice. But again, it was a thrilling time. A pioneer had a milkman who supplied the milk for the assembly, although it was rationed. He had to be very careful what he did, of course. And of course the brothers all supplied coal to get the furnaces going to boil the water. Everything came easily, really, for us.
How wonderful now that after all these years, finally there was to be a dedicated assembly hall in the Bristol area. In the autumn of 1994, the watertight shell had been completed and the witness volunteer workers took over. Their first task was to seal the hall from the elements, and a team of brothers and sisters placed slate tiles on the roof, while witness specialists carefully erected the striking glass curtain walls at the front of the building. Once the hall was weatherproof, work could begin on installing the internal fittings. The first of these was the air handling unit and all the ducting. Designed to change all the air in the building every few minutes, the system is powered by gas and controlled by a sophisticated computerized control bank.
Well, basically, all the ventilation and the heating works on sensors. Now, the sensors come in on these grey wires, and they take readings of the temperature all around the auditorium, and then they're controlled by these three trend computers. And you've got a small trend computer there. Now what they do, they send the signal back to the original program, which is in the hall overseer's office, which then comes back to these via this and this one, and that tells which pumps, which heaters, which boilers to switch on and off, which fan units to switch on and off depending on the temperature. That's as simple as it is.
A standby generator was installed that would run all the hall facilities in the event of a mains power cut. Its purchase was an example of the way vital materials were obtained at favourable prices, in this case from a hospital that was closing down.
We managed to secure a good deal on the generator, and it's quite capable of running the assembly without us having to abandon it halfway through. We can continue to run the assembly, and the interruption in power is about 4 seconds.
got a bonus.
It's run only 125 hours so far. And we'll use it to run the site for construction.
On the upper deck, work was well underway to pave the entire car park. Since most of the building is under the ground, the car park is laid on top of it.
Because the whole of the area, the car parking and the driveways, are surfaced with block paving, like this. And these are laid on a bed of sand, thin bed of sand, on ordinary subbase or hardcore that is used to form the foundation of the roadways. And whether you can notice these little nibs on the sides of the blocks and one on each end, space the blocks apart sufficient to give a little gap into which kiln-dried sand is brushed, which gives the whole system strength. It locks them together. It's a single size, very fine sand that is very dry and is just brushed into the gap between the two blocks, and it locks it all together. Very clever, really. There are about just over 250,000 of these, laid all by hand and cut on the edges and up against channels and so on, and together they form the complete surface of the drives and car parking.
It was back-breaking work, but the paving team kept going until the last tiny piece was slotted into place. One of the outside storerooms was turned into a metal fabrication workshop, and all the steel handrail frames and other fixtures and fittings were made right on site. Most of what they made here was destined to be hidden. The handrails, for example, would eventually be capped with polished timber, sawn and shaped in the fully equipped joinery workshop. Almost all the joinery was crafted from the finest ash, chosen for its distinctive grain and hard-wearing characteristics. In keeping with this use of natural materials, some of the boulders blasted out of the site in those early days were broken down and used to create features within the auditorium. It took over 14 tons to build this wall, and tiny fragments of quartzite and pyrites were put to good use.
What we're doing is a form of work called galloting. It means putting in all these little slivers here, look. So we don't want to lose them, because if we don't put them in the wall, they'll be lost. So here, the brothers can enjoy them like that for as long as they stay in and people don't take them out with a penknife.
26 tons of stone went into this water feature, along with many hours of work. The finished result made it all worthwhile. Everyone here recognized something special about the site. Even non-witness visitors commented on the unusual atmosphere. It was as if this was not just a physical building project, but a small oasis of peace.
The joy of working with your brothers and sisters and having 95% of the time when problems arise, you can go and talk to your brothers and sisters and they're all delighted to try to work together to overcome the problems. On a worldly site, you'd have fisticuffs, people would be swearing at one another, fights would break out, people would walk off site and not want to come back again. And we don't have that with our brothers and sisters, and that really is a delightful atmosphere in which to work. It's a breath of the paradise new world already this side of Armageddon.
Of course, this doesn't mean there were no problems. Any project as big as this will suffer from many, but never were they insurmountable. Sometimes solutions were found that were the result of amazing coincidences. Robert Willey has been on the project almost from the beginning of the construction period, and he commented on this.
It seems that every time a particular problem's identified, maybe we're short of materials, maybe we're waiting for some special service that a brother can offer us, some special skills, we identify it, and within two or three days, brother sends a form in, or someone rings up and says, have you heard? I know somebody who can do. And it's almost as if the angels that Jehovah's assigned to the project, well, they're busy, they're watching in the wings, and here it is just waiting for us to use.
One of the significant challenges was the ceiling. Designed to conceal lighting and air vents, the construction team found that there were no volunteers on the register who were skilled in plasterboarding. Despite requests, no skilled volunteers were found. The only possible solution was to send appropriate brothers on a training course. Unfortunately, the course was for simple plasterboard techniques, and the trainees returned none the wiser for the task set before them. So, how would they get on? Back in the 17th century BCE, when the Jews became God's chosen nation, Jehovah miraculously inspired the builders of his tabernacle to produce magnificent results with little or no experience. Years later, when King Solomon built the glorious temple in Jerusalem, King Hiram of Tyre sent a master builder to oversee the work. In each case, it could be said, Jehovah has done a great thing. So it was with the Bristol Assembly Hall. Supported on a forest of scaffolding, the ceiling workers carefully assembled the complex aluminium framework and clad it with plasterboard. Then the joints were carefully filled and sealed, and the whole thing painted brilliant white. When they had finished, no one could tell that it had been created by relatively inexperienced people. Here again, the words on everyone's lips were, Jehovah has done a great thing. Keith Dyer remembers all the hard work and sacrifices that were made.
Nobody had ever done one like that before. There are so many different planes, and the materials that we had to use to achieve it weren't really manufactured for that sort of thing. But the actual end result, the combination of planes and the lighting system that we have there that shows them off in different degrees of light and shadow, it's fantastic. Yeah, our biggest single problem with it all has been the labour, because it's part-time labour, and very few tradesmen come along. We'll end up training our own labour, and they come in for 2 days and you train them what to do. Second day they've got it, third day it's somebody else, so you start all over again. So that's been the biggest single problem, but fantastic spirit all the way through it. You're on a high all the time, you know. You work a 15-hour day, and at the end of the day, you can't go to sleep. Fantastic spirit. Some brothers have climbed mountains to be here, but been determined to achieve it, and they've enjoyed it. But it's been a long 2 years.
Delays caused by the ceiling had severely disrupted the schedule. And so the pressure mounted as spring turned into summer and the August the 5th deadline approached. The brothers and sisters responded by working longer hours, and day by day, progress was visible. Despite the pressures building up, it was obvious that Jehovah's Spirit was still with them.
Basically, I'm a pioneer, so I do all the ministry work in the week. And that takes you out of you a bit. So when I come here in midweek, it really builds me up. Gives me the strength to carry on. Such a lovely atmosphere over here, working with the brothers and the sisters. It really is an uplifting experience.
It's brilliant. I've enjoyed myself, and you know, I felt such a sense of satisfaction before in anything I've done. It's great.
Yes, the day in your courtyard, the scripture says, is worth a thousand spent elsewhere, and that's how I feel about it.
Thank you. Well, here we are about 5 days before dedication. And when you look around the hall and see exactly what has been accomplished in the last few weeks, has truly been amazing. And the decor, the seating design, and the lights for the auditorium have proved to be such a wonderful attraction that when the brothers first see it, they will know that the hard work's gone into it on our behalf has truly been worth it all. So just being about 5 days away, we've still got quite a lot of work to do with the carpentry. We've got quite a lot of work to do with the carpet laying. But putting those two together, we hope that by Wednesday evening, that nearly all the jobs will be totally finished. As you notice, all the landscaping is in place, the trees are planted, and even the grass is coming up. So we feel very confident that everything will be in place for dedication.
When dedication day arrived, the project team were relieved that the hall was indeed finished. 1,200 brothers and sisters who'd been involved with the project in some way over its 10-year life were invited to the dedication ceremony on the Saturday. They were unanimous in showing their appreciation for the quality of the hall and for their involvement in it. For over 3 hours, they listened to experiences and reminiscences about the project. The theme of the presentation was Little by Little, and it showed how the project was advanced in small steps, not with monumental events. Jehovah's spirit and guidance had been apparent in overcoming many problems, and everyone paid tribute to the spiritual quality of the project. The day was not without its humorous side, however, and Brother John Furneaux, one of the original project committee members, related a story that occurred one dark, stormy day.
You see, time and again, we've seen the operation of Jehovah's Holy Spirit on this site. Coincidences do not happen week in, week out. Jehovah's Spirit has been real. Although, admittedly, sometimes only in the stretched imagination of the workers. Let me illustrate. Try and imagine the scene during morning worship on a very stormy day. Now, as the safety talk is in progress, suddenly all the electricity goes out. Everybody looks at the trade overseer for electrical services. Peter Sargent. As he stands up, there is a huge clap of thunder, and all the lights come back on again. Round of applause. 5 minutes later, when the lights go out once more, everyone again looks at Peter Sargent. Now, whilst initially refusing to move, and I make no comment further on that statement, the continuing darkness encouraged him at least to do something, and so he stood up. And there is another loud clap of thunder, and all the lights come back on again. Obviously, having such good connections, he was asked to close in prayer.
Brother Tony Reynolds, another committee member, next interviewed numerous project workers for their stories. From their experiences, one point kept recurring. This hall was built for the most part by brothers and sisters with little construction experience, but with the will to learn. Brother Dyer referred to this shortage of skilled labour when he related the story of the ceiling and how they'd sent a team of brothers on a plasterboarding course.
Now look at the ceiling. It took us a long time, over 10,000 hours, to build that ceiling. There's 8 miles of steel in there, and 600 plasterboards, and thousands of screws. And they were the most unpopular brothers and sisters on the site in the end. Because not only did they have to build it, they had to cover it and sandpaper it. And can you imagine the dust in here with sandpapering going on? And when we finished it, we looked at it. We took the scaffold down. We couldn't see it until we took the scaffold down. And we couldn't believe it. Those brothers and sisters we sent away on that course had come back and they'd sculpted the ceiling for us.
Brother Dyer went on to point out the benefits of the humble and willing spirit of the construction team.
At the end of it, we can all look back and say that the thought in 2 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 and 7, where it says, humble yourself and Jehovah will exalt you. This is the reward of humbling ourselves. The reward of the brothers and the love that they showed.
One after another, the brothers and sisters related the story of the Bristol Assembly Hall, and their joy at being a part was readily apparent. All of them had seen for themselves that it was Jehovah who had done this great thing. Of the governing body of Jehovah's Witnesses, Brother Jack Barr had been invited to present the dedication address. He too was overwhelmed by the beauty of the hall.
It really is a wonderful sight when you first see this assembly hall. Every assembly hall, you know, has a personality, and this one certainly has a very, very distinct personality. The whole design of the assembly hall is really very attractive, draws you to it. The decor of the hall itself, including this curtain that was chosen for the backdrop, it really is beautiful, brothers, and all its various anterooms, pleasant, soothing to the eye, the decor is. Outside landscaping, very attractive. And increasingly so it'll become as the rain comes down and you find it all growing up. I can imagine that because I've seen such before. Seating so comfortable. Wherever you are, you can see so easily. And by the way, on the seats up on the, going up on the slope there, whoever thought of that idea of a rest for your feet deserves commendation. That's a great, that's another distinctive feature of the hall. So when we come to our lovely assembly hall, as you will be doing every twice a year, and here publicly discuss from this platform our hope of a new world of righteousness, is going to stir up within you a renewed sense, renewed feeling of determination to hold fast our individual hope, in spite of all the little ups and downs that we might have in life due to our imperfections and various setbacks. You see, programs that are going to be held in this assembly hall is going to incite us to love, to find works. And so we're going to be able to go back to our congregation assignment more determined than ever before to spread abroad the knowledge of Jehovah. And so the purpose of this assembly hall is going to be accomplished time and time again. Now, I've drawn up a resolution here. I'd like to read it to you. And if you are in agreement, please show this at the end in no uncertain terms. On this fifth day of August 1995, all of us here assembled resolved to dedicate this beautiful new Bristol Assembly Hall to the one and only true God, Jehovah, and that it will be used for the following purposes. First, to promote the true worship of our God, Jehovah. Second, to build up faith in God's now reigning King Christ Jesus and in Jesus' shed blood as man's only means of redemption. Third, to further Bible instruction and education for living in harmony with the divine principles outlined in God's word. And fourth and last, to further the work of preaching and teaching the kingdom good news and thus share in filling the earth with the knowledge and glory of Jehovah. How many here present are in heart harmony with such a resolution? I'm sure all the angels heard that. It's a wonderful sight, you know, brothers, to look, 1,200 people, all showing their appreciation by clapping in that way of such a resolution. I always like to remember this, that although it makes all of our hearts glad, how do you think it makes Jehovah and Christ Jesus and the millions of angels on such an occasion as this? But I trust that all of you now appreciate, perhaps a little more fully than ever before, after this wonderful program, the vitally important part that this Bristol Assembly Hall of Jehovah's Witnesses is going to play in this overall magnificent purpose of Jehovah to fill the earth with his knowledge, with his glory, all to the sanctification of his name, the vindication of his sovereignty.
While the dedication program was in full swing at Bristol, the Cardiff National Stadium was being prepared for the Sunday meeting, when nearly 20,000 would arrive for the second day of the celebrations. Hundreds of local brothers spent the day cleaning and installing equipment ready for the next day's program.
Yeah.
audience was treated to a three-hour presentation similar to the previous day's programme. It was a day to remember. The choir delighted the audience once again, filling the stadium with the glorious sound of kingdom praises. One of the highlights was a parade of representatives of all the trades used in the construction of the Assembly Hall. The final part of the programme was one that everyone had been waiting for. Brother Jack Barr presented a talk on the theme of Make the Truth Your Own. He encouraged all, both young and old, to treasure the truth and never let themselves draw away from it.
While Jesus walked this earth and whatever he was doing, wherever he was, his life was constantly intertwined with God's heavenly family of angels. The angels supported Jesus through all of his life. Just think, an angel was involved before even Jesus was born in that message given to Mary. And when he was born, they were there all right, weren't they? Great multitudes of them singing praises to Jehovah. And after Jesus' three temptations in the wilderness, just at the time he needed them most, angels were there ready to minister to him. Jesus knew that angels were there in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was under such tremendous pressure. How many? Matthew 26, verse 53 tells us that Jesus said that he could call more than 12 legions of angels to his help. That's up to and maybe more than 72,000 angels, and every angel, look at the power that it possesses. And they were active and alert at the moment of his death, bringing darkness and earthquakes, splitting the temple curtain in two. You remember that? And they were on the spot at the time of his resurrection, comforting the disciples. Now, I could mention other features of this matter, but can you begin to imagine the comfort that Jesus must have constantly got from knowing the truth about God's great heavenly family backing him up? He knew he could call them to his aid, but at times he didn't do it that, of course. That wasn't his Father's will, but he knew that they were there. And Jesus knew that this same truth would be of tremendous comfort to his followers. What about us today? Jesus told his disciples that when he would return in kingdom power, you remember what Jesus said would happen? Matthew 25, verse 31, all the holy angels would be with him. Wonderful thing to think about, that Jesus, now enthroned as the messianic king in the heavens, has got all the angels associated with him. So can you, can I, by the eye of faith, see these mighty angelic forces backing us up? Can we? Oh yes, brothers, make no doubt about it. Our lives today are as intertwined with God's heavenly family of angels as Jesus and his earthly disciples' lives were. This truth becomes a reality to us when we make the truth of God's word our own. It's only here in the Bible that we know about this wonderful truth, how this strengthens and sustains us. Just as it did Jacob, as it did Jesus, that cloud of faithful witnesses, to know that God is with us. He'll keep us in all the way that we are going in this exciting time of the end. Never forget, this is the most important education that you'll ever go through, making the truth your own with the help of God's word, because it means your everlasting life.
Brother Barr's concluding comments matched precisely the feeling of all those thousands of brothers and sisters in attendance.
So may all of us continue, more than ever before, to make the truth our own. And as we do, may the words of the Apostle Paul at 1 Corinthians 15:58 be of constant encouragement to us, become steadfast, unmovable, always having plenty to do in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in connection with the Lord. Brothers, it's been a great pleasure to be back here in Wales after many years and to share that wonderful program that we all so much enjoyed, which was a reflection, a big reflection, of the dedication of your beautiful new Bristol Assembly Hall. Thank you.
For 10 years, the Bristol Assembly Hall has absorbed the efforts of hundreds of brothers and sisters. It's the result of thousands of man-hours in design, manufacture, excavation, and construction. Now that the project is over, the Bristol Assembly Hall stands ready to fulfill its primary purpose, the true worship of Jehovah. Circuit assemblies now make full use of the facilities from autumn till early summer. As well as benefiting from Bible-based instruction, all delegates can witness the baptism of those who have dedicated their lives to Jehovah. After the dedication talk, the curtains at the rear of the platform are drawn back, revealing the baptism pool to the entire audience. It's always the highlight of the assembly. At other times, visitors are able to appreciate the many features of the assembly hall, such as the paintings in the dining room. Well-known Bible events are pictured, delighting young and old as they examine the colorful details. The most noticeable feature of the dining room is the waterfall. This unplanned bonus was made possible by the discovery of attractive stone during the excavation of the site. Each spring, one end of the dining room becomes the venue for the Pioneer School. The first school was held in January 1996 and was attended by 30 appreciative brothers and sisters who enjoyed 2 weeks of intensive Bible study. Taking their new knowledge and understanding back to their congregations, these pioneers are another tangible benefit of the Bristol Assembly Hall. They, along with all the other visitors, including perhaps you and your family, will no doubt agree with the psalmist. Jehovah has done a great thing.